This video is brought to you by Green Man Gaming, who are always doing huge discounts on the latest and greatest titles, including Destiny 2 Lightfall, which they're currently selling for 16% off. That is huge, so if you want to get in on that, click the link in the description below, or stick around to the end of the video to learn more. Gamers! Much like the post-coital, post-E3 window, this post-Gamescom week has been fairly quiet on the news front. I mean, it almost wasn't, what with that Amazon buying EA rumor surfacing before vanishing like a fart in the wind. But with that turning into a nothing burger, the rest of the week was pretty chill, actually, which was nice. It makes for a fun episode, actually, since it allows us to dig back and touch on some of the stories that got pushed out of the news cycle owing to all of the Gamescom hype last week. For example, did you know that there was an Iron Man game in the works for like 2 years and then it got canned? Did you know that details about Blizzard's upcoming survival game have leaked? Did you know that Sakurai is a YouTuber now? That is a real thing, believe it. If any of this comes as a shock to you, then you are in the right place, my friend. Hold on to your butts, because here comes the news. Why don't we deal with that Amazon EA rumor first, because goddamn, that was a trip. Okay, so we're all sitting around, going about our business, excitedly waiting for the announcement of Taylor Swift's next album, then boom! A media company by the name of Good Luck Have Fun, who published on USA Today's website, reported that Amazon were about to announce the acquisition of Electronic Arts, aka EA, aka that fucking loot box company run by Handsome Jack. This was huge industry-shaking news. EA is worth about 35 billion bucks, and Amazon are worth about 1.3 trillion. So this is the equivalent of Amazon buying a packet of cigarettes, but some really nice ones in a fancy box or something. I don't know, I don't smoke. This news wouldn't have been altogether surprising either, as it's been well documented that EA have long been in the market for a suitor. There was reporting that EA has been in discussion with Disney, Apple, and Amazon, but none of those discussions had borne fruit. Until now, right? Wrong. Just as soon as this report went out, the market ran with it, pumping EA's stock price considerably. Even though the reporting was pretty light on sources and detail, all of this came tumbling down a few hours later when CNBC took a big fat dump on the report. On-air hosts gleefully derided Good Luck Have Fun, calling this report a Swedish meatball report, and saying that they confirmed with their sources, people who actually know, and they all confirmed that no such deal was happening, at least not to their knowledge. Sure enough, the day came and went, and no acquisition announcement had been made, and many days have passed since then, and so this report has aged like soft cheese on a summer's day. So complete was the drubbing of the report that even USA Today, who published it, got in on it. They posted an update to their original story saying, quote, "Earlier today, Good Luck Have Fun, a gaming esports outlet and content partner for the win, ran a version of this story on our website that violated our editorial standards regarding the use of unnamed and unvetted sources. We have updated this story to remove all mention of those sources," end quote. Ouch. So does this mean that EA will not be acquired? No. As has been reported, they really want to be acquired. But will they be acquired by Amazon last week? No, that question is nonsense, just like this report apparently. There was another piece of industry-shaking news this week, but unlike that Amazon story, this one was actually true, though people certainly wish it wasn't. Blue Team, House, Ryan, the Pony Stables, whatever you want to call it, Sony announced this week that the price of the PlayStation is going up. The very first time I can recall a console price going up in the whole time I've been aware that video games exist, and that was about age 4. Sony announced the unprecedented move in a blog post saying, quote, "The global economic environment is a challenge that many of you around the world are no doubt experiencing. We're seeing high global inflation rates, as well as adverse currency trends impacting consumers and creating pressure on many industries. Based on these challenging economic conditions, Sony Interactive Entertainment has made the difficult decision to increase the recommended retail price of PlayStation 5 in select markets across Europe, Middle East and Africa, Asia Pacific, Latin America, as well as Canada. There will be no price increase in the United States," end quote. The increase breaks differently for each region. For example, in Australia, it's 50 bucks, which isn't great, but it isn't earth-shattering either. Europeans got the worst of it though, the price increasing a full 50 euros, very steep indeed. That's almost enough to buy a whole new game. Not a PS5 game, of course, I mean, that's 70 euros. The price hike is a bold move. It's a time when everyone is feeling squeezed owing to inflation, rising energy costs, and rising interest rates. It's also, as I mentioned earlier, an unprecedented move, since console prices, much like gravity, go down over time, not up. They are purposely priced at a heavy premium at launch and cascade ever downward in the years that follow. This marks the first occasion where buying a new console was like locking in some sort of pre-order discount. Truly wild times. So are people buying the line that this is because of prevailing economic conditions and not just Sony trying to skim a little cream at a time when they already can't keep up with demand? People are split. I've definitely seen both takes. Personally, I'm inclined to believe them. I mean, my fucking grocery bill has gone up like 30 or 40% in the last few months alone. Hell, we were paying $7 for a head of lettuce recently here in Australia. They were putting cabbage in our Zinger burgers because KFC couldn't afford lettuce. That is a true story. So yeah, I do believe them when they say the costs have gone up. But if that's the case, then why hasn't the price gone up in the US as well? A cynical reading might be that Sony have an entrenched lead in those other regions, where the race between PlayStation and Xbox is much closer in the land of the free. Did Sony think they could get away with a price increase elsewhere but didn't want to risk it in the US? I don't know, but it's not a good look, and it makes the whole costs going up argument a little hard to swallow when you aren't passing those costs onto your largest market. With Sony making this announcement, attention immediately turned to both Microsoft and Nintendo. Surely they're subject to the same pressures that Sony are, right? Well, if they are, they're choosing to wear those costs rather than pass them on. Both Microsoft and Nintendo issued statements saying they won't be increasing the costs of their consoles, putting Sony in an awkward position where they now have the most expensive console on the market and the most expensive games on the market, since they were pioneers with that whole $70 price tag. Bottom line though, will this slow demand for PS5s? No, demand is already through the roof, to the point where Sony literally cannot make enough PS5s to meet it. But will this hurt the narrative around PlayStation and Sony's approach to this generation? I think it will, at least a little. Stuff like this, the Horizon Forbidden West upgrade path thing, the Ghost of Tsushima upgrade price, and the $70 Last of Us remake, these are all pricing decisions that have served as distractions, shifting the conversation away from the sterling quality of Sony's products and more towards the cost of those products. It feels like a bit of an own goal, but I guess Sony's bigwigs feel like it's a price worth paying. Some other Sony news we didn't get to cover last week. Apparently, Sony weren't the reason that Cult of the Lamb didn't end up on Game Pass. The background to this is that Microsoft recently claimed that Sony were paying publishers to keep games off Microsoft's subscription service, a claim that Sony hasn't to this point refuted. It wasn't clear which games were affected by this, but screenwriter and Kinda Funny regular Gary Widder claimed that Cult of the Lamb was one such game. This was a big accusation to make and led Cult of the Lamb publisher Devolver Digital to issue a response calling that absolutely untrue. They didn't elaborate any further, but hey, at least the record is straight for now. The Sony news keeps coming. It was revealed this week that the PlayStation version of Hogwarts Legacy will have an exclusive quest not available on other platforms. That's pretty shitty. Been a while since we've seen this sort of exclusive content negotiated into platforms. Last one I can think of was Spider-Man being exclusive to the Avengers on PlayStation, and yeah, everyone loved that. Hopefully this exclusive content is no big deal, since it's always pretty lame when console makers and publishers indulge this sort of nonsense. No one's gonna fucking buy a PS5 so they can play one extra quest in a Hogwarts game. All this achieves is just pissing people off. Ridiculous. Alright, last piece of Sony news, I promise. We got an update on the Horizon Zero Dawn TV show. This looks like it's actually moving forward since it now has a showrunner attached to it. Deadline reported this week that Steve Blackman will helm the show, best known for his work on Umbrella Academy. That show is to enter its fourth and final season, meaning that Horizon will be his next major project. This will be in collaboration with Michelle Lovretta, best known for her work on the Umbrella Academy as well. The series will be appearing on Netflix, but there's no word yet on when it'll arrive. It surely won't be any time before 2024. Okay, I lied. One more piece of Sony news, but it's still in the video game adaptation space. Let's just count it as a continuation of the previous story. We are getting a Days Gone movie. Maybe. Deadline are reporting that Sony are feeling particularly buoyant after the success of Uncharted, which apparently wasn't even that good, but it still made a boatload of money. Apparently, Sony are tapping a few people on the shoulder to set a Days Gone movie adaptation in train, with the guy from Outlander interested in starring as Sam and Oscar-nominated writer Sheldon Turner adapting. This guy did Up in the Air, The Texas Chainsaw Massacre, and X-Men First Class, so that's a pretty good CV right there. Do we need a Days Gone movie, though? I don't know, man. I liked it, don't get me wrong. I was one of the few reviewers that did like it. But do I think the source material deserves a movie? Not really. We have like 85 seasons of The Walking Dead to get through, including like 15 spin-offs. Surely that's enough zombie television to last us for a lifetime. Oh yeah, and we have The Last of Us coming as well. I totally forgot about that. No, that settles it. We don't need a Days Gone movie, okay? Make a Crash Bandicoot movie. Give Sonic some competition, like the old days. I'd watch that. You know what else I'd watch? A Bioshock movie. And wouldn't you know it, Netflix are making one. This project was announced a little while ago, but it now has a director and writer. Francis Lawrence directed I Am Legend, The Hunger Games: Catching Fire, and Slumbered. And he'll be directing the movie, which is based on a script written by Michael Green, the dude who wrote Logan, Blade Runner 2049, and the adaptation of American Gods. That is a fucking cool collection of movies and TV shows. These are some talented dudes, and it's nice to see heavyweight updates like this attached to a Bioshock movie, a movie that could be so fucking cool if it was done right. It wasn't all video game TV show and movie announcements this week though. There are also some cancellations. Netflix's Resident Evil series has been cancelled after one season, to which most people responded, good. I didn't watch the series, but I heard very bad things about it, so it wasn't exactly high on my watch list. Speaking on the cancellation, star Lance Reddick took to Twitter to post a brief message. Quote, so I wanted to do this video so that I could do some acknowledgements and some thank yous. All of you are aware by now our show Resident Evil on Netflix has been cancelled, and whether we wanted to or not, we stepped into a war with the Cabal on Mars. So let's get to taking out their command one by one. There's more after that, but you get the gist. Okay, let's check out those Blizzard survival game leaks. These dropped last week, but amidst all the Gamescom excitement, I didn't have a chance to cover them off. You may recall that Blizzard have announced this survival title, but mainly so they could recruit talent for it, since Blizzard was and is struggling to recruit people in the wake of the cultural reckoning that has rocked Blizzard this past 18 months. We hadn't heard any more about the title since then, but last week, Jez Corden was speaking during his Xbox 2 podcast, and he dumped a bunch of information about it. So he claims to have seen actual gameplay, and he says it looks amazing, describing it as looking like Everwild, that Rare game that's sort of stuck in development hell right now, and it's been rebooted a bunch of times. But still, the art style is both distinct and striking, so a survival game adopting that motif would be pretty great. Jez said that the title is currently codenamed Project Odyssey, a detail that was confirmed by Jason Schreier in a Reddit thread on the topic. Jez says that the game does have plenty of base building mechanics, which is fairly stock standard for a survival game, but he also describes a focus on mercantile trade crafts. For example, you could build a potion shop and then sell those potions to other players. He said it kind of reminded him of Fallout 76 without being, you know, complete fucking trash. My words, not his. Jeff did make the point that the footage he saw was some months old, but everything he said was encouraging. I really firmly believe that the survival genre, as popular as it is, still awaits the arrival of the perfect survival game, and if there's one thing Blizzard have been good at, it's taking more niche gaming subgenres, sanding back their rough edges, and making them accessible to a massive audience. They did it with RTS, they did it with MMOs, they did it with card games. Can they do it with survival? I hope so, because that'd be pretty cool, I think. While we're on the topic of Blizzard, you may have missed the recent Diablo 4 quarterly update, which was an important one, since it was the first time that Blizzard have spoken at length about their plans to monetize the long-awaited sequel. They did confirm that Diablo 4 will be a live service game supported by a large team of developers for many years to come. That support will manifest most notably in the form of seasons, where new content, gear, and cosmetics will be rolled out at regular intervals. It was implied that these seasons would be free, supported by a season pass that has both a free track and a paid track. The season pass will award gameplay affecting boosters in the free tier, but the paid tier will be reserved for cosmetics only. That paid tier will also award premium currency that can be used in Diablo 4's cash shop to purchase cosmetics, and again, Blizzard repeated that nothing sold in the cash shop would affect gameplay in any way. Speaking in more detail about the shop, Blizzard said they want to provide a range of cosmetic items, but that the best looking items won't be reserved for the cash shop only. We'll see about that, I guess. They also spoke about transparency, which means being able to preview your purchases before slapping down that premium currency, and presumably no paid loot boxes, though they didn't rule that out in this update. So all of this is cool, they're definitely saying all the right things. Bottom line though, I don't believe anything they say. This is a company that developed and shipped a game where you can spend hundreds of thousands of dollars to gear up a character and then take those characters into PvP to completely ruin everyone's day without any concern given to fairness, competitive integrity, or just basic good game design. Diablo Immortal cannot be waved away as an aberration or excused by the mobile market it caters to. It's an enduring monument to Blizzard's complete abandonment of the core values that made them great in the past. It is, by design, ruthlessly exploitative, and as long as it exists in the way that it does, we should never, ever trust anything that Blizzard says about monetization, and we should only ever expect the absolute worst from them. Alright, one last story before we hit the lightning round. There was an Iron Man video game in development for like 2 years, and then it got canned. Very sad times. This news comes courtesy of the MinMax YouTube channel, who were interviewing Christopher Sundberg, formerly of Avalanche Studios, the team behind the Just Cause games. He revealed that Avalanche were contracted to make an Iron Man game in around 2010, and worked on the title for a full 2 years before it was eventually cancelled, owing to what he calls company politics. Quote, I was a mess by the end, he said. It was like shortening development time, increasing budget. We would have had to hire 70 or 80 people to the team that I would have had the responsibility to find a new project for, but the development time was shortened down so much that it was impossible to do. It would have broken the studio completely if we had agreed to that, end quote. For what it's worth, there are rumors that EA are working on an Iron Man game. That's been reported by 3 people at this point. So yeah, hopefully there's some truth to it, because if there's one thing that Anthem showed us, it's that we need an Iron Man game. Man, I really hope they get Robert Downey Jr. to voice that. That would be super cool. All right, 2 quick items for the lightning round. First up, Jeff Grubb is reporting that Jedi Survivor, the sequel to Fallen Order, will drop around March next year. This coincides with the release of a book that links the events of the 2 games, much like Shadows of the Empire linked Empire and Jedi. Great Nintendo 64 game, by the way, absolute classic. Finally, the PSVR 2 is set to make its official debut at the Tokyo Game Show just a few weeks from now. Sony and Capcom have announced that the PSVR 2 will be playable there, showcasing the upcoming Resident Evil Village VR port. This is a bit of an odd way to do a hands-on reveal, since these sorts of things usually get their own dedicated events, but hey, it works, and we should have impressions from select outlets very soon. So, what got announced or delayed this week? Well, one thing that caught my eye was Floodland. It's a survival strategy game that would have felt like Kevin Costner's Waterworld if it weren't also a dire, sobering warning about the path we're currently on re-climate change. Got a nice art style, it looks very chill, but for the grim premise, I guess, and it's out fairly soon, November 15th, exclusive to PC at this point. Gungrave Gore got a spectacular cinematic reveal trailer a while back and went radio silent for a long ass time after that. It's resurfaced this week with a new trailer and also some gameplay courtesy of Gamescom hands-on sessions. There is a release date locked in for it now as well, November 22nd, exclusive to PlayStation. Very surprised to see this next one, Fear Effect Reinvented. Now apparently this was revealed a while back, but it completely flew under my radar, which is a surprise to me because I absolutely loved the old Fear Effect games back in the day, and I thought I would have heard something about it if they were bringing them back. Anyway, the project has progressed and we got a look at actual gameplay here, and I don't know, man. So the thing about Fear Effect, its defining characteristic really, was its art style, which set bright, stylized characters against dark, gritty, pre-rendered backgrounds. This is a very big departure from that. This whole thing is so bright and all the backgrounds are so clean looking. Plus the shooting looks a little rough, but that's definitely true to the original, I guess. I don't know, I'm interested to see where this goes, but for now, I'm gonna take a wait and see approach. There's no date for this one yet, but the trailer does say sooner than you think, so perhaps it's dropping sometime this year. Rift of the Necrodancer was officially revealed this week, after earlier being teased by the developer in a trailer for a Crypt of the Necrodancer update. A new standalone spin-off title, Rift of the Necrodancer, is very, very different from Crypt, as it appears to be a collection of rhythm-based minigames that look one part Guitar Hero and one part yoga class? Either way, it looks fun, and this team clearly know what they're doing when it comes to rhythm-based shenanigans. There's no date for this one yet, but you can wishlist it now on Steam. This next one is very hot off the presses, so I'm glad I was able to squeeze it into this video. There's a new Mafia game currently in development. To celebrate the 20th anniversary of the franchise, some of the OG developers over at Hangar 13 did an interview, and at the end they dropped this low-key bombshell. Quote, "I'm happy to confirm we've started work on an all-new Mafia project. While it's a few years away and we can't share anything more right now, we're really excited to keep working on this beloved franchise and to entertain our players with new stories," end quote. This isn't a huge surprise, but it is a welcome one. The remake of the original game was extremely well received, and while the remasters of 2 and 3 met a much more mixed reception, it did prove the demand for the franchise was still alive and well. Let's just hope that Mafia 4 doesn't follow in Saints Row's footsteps. And finally, the only other release date announcement was for one of the 85 projects that Obsidian is currently working on. This one, Pentiment, the historically themed generation-spanning murder mystery pulled straight from the pages of the Dark Ages, or around that time, I think. I actually attended a briefing on this one with the dev team recently, and it was so interesting to hear how committed the team is to delivering a totally out-of-the-box, unique experience that is grounded not only in history, but in the way that history is recorded. There are just so many tiny details packed into this that I don't suspect we'll notice half of them as we play through it, and I look forward to all of the YouTube essays that carefully pick apart this game's phenomenal presentation. Anyway, Pentiment is coming to Xbox and PC on November 15th, and it will of course be day one on Game Pass. So what came out last week? Well, to be honest, a few things, but we covered them in the previous episode since all the review embargoes were up early. TLDR, Midnight Fight Express is pretty good. Pac-Man World is more Pac-Man World. Soul Hackers 2 is far from Atlas's best showing. And Saints Row is very, very not good. If you'd like to hear more about each of those, then I'll leave a timestamped link to last week's episode below the like button. So, what's coming out this week? Well, this week marks the beginning of the end of 2022. The release cycle for the year takes a deep breath in the July and August period, only so it can belch out the biggest hitters in September, October, and November, filling our Christmas stockings with more video than we can shake a candy cane at. This week is proof positive of that, as it's absolutely stacked with all manner of releases, from DLC to AAA blockbusters, from obscure FMV puzzle games to anime fighting games. It's all here. So let's kick off then. First up is Back for Blood, Children of the Worm, which is the next paid DLC drop for the Left 4 Dead spiritual successor. Word on the street is that this title has improved significantly since launch, with a major overhaul to a few key game systems like the cards and enemy spawn rates at different difficulties. The Children of the Worm update might be a good excuse to jump back in, as it does add an entirely new act to the main story, as well as new enemies, new weapons, and a new playable character. It's out on all platforms but the Switch today. Destroy All Humans 2 Reprobed follows in the footsteps of the previous remaster to deliver a solid remake of a classic title that hasn't aged super well, but well enough to hold some appeal for fans. The reviews for this one hit a few days back, and Open Critic currently has it at a fair 70, which is about where the first remaster landed as well. IGN scored this a 6, saying, quote, "While Destroy All Humans 2 Reprobe does a respectable job of making his second Rampage look good, its small assortment of new weapons and enemies make it feel like an unambitious expansion rather than a sequel," end quote. If you're looking to get your crypto on, this is hitting PS5, Xbox Series consoles, and the PC today. F1 Manager is an F1 management game. Can you make the cars go really fast through the power of management? Fuck, man, I know nothing about F1, but to be fair, I am thinking about taking an interest in it, since it does appear to have the best of all the sports merch. Anyway, F1 Manager is hitting all platforms bar the Switch today. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Cowabunga Collection is my childhood condensed into a single video game package. 13 Turtles games spanning 3 console generations and the arcade cabinets. This collection pays homage to the greatest troop of anthropomorphic martial arts trained animals that the 80s and 90s had to offer. And believe me, there were others. Go look them up. The Cowabunga Collection hits all platforms today. Here's one that looked kind of cool. Tinykin. We're not getting a new Pikmin anytime soon, so we'll have to settle for this one. But for what it's worth, it seems like it's looking pretty great. Reviews dropped a few days ago, and the game currently sits at a strong 83 on Open Critic. GameSpew loved it, scoring it a 9 out of 10 and saying, quote, "No matter who you are, we challenge you to play Tinykin without a stupid grin on your face from start to finish. This is an utterly wholesome adventure game packed with charm, clever ideas, puzzles, and exploration," end quote. And God is a Geek were equally impressed, scoring it a 9 and saying, quote, "Tinykin is a joyous and unthreatening exploration-based 3D platformer with a ridiculous amount of charm," end quote. Looks to be a bit of a sleeper hit, this one. If you're keen, you can grab it on all platforms today. Immortality. God damn, am I pumped for this one. As I've mentioned earlier, this is the latest work from Sam Barlow, the dude behind Telling Lies and Her Story, the latter being one of my favorite games ever, really. The buzz around this one is huge. Edge awarded it a rare 10 out of 10. I've spoken to another reviewer who plans to give it a 10 as well. And yeah, this is shaping up to be pretty special. This one is exclusive to Xbox and PC at launch, and it is on Game Pass as a day one launch title. It is out today. Do yourself a favor and check it out. It is at the very tippity top of my list this week, and I cannot wait. Scathe is a title that looks really interesting, but there hasn't been a lot of marketing push behind it, so you'd be forgiven for not knowing that it exists. Obviously, it's got a very Doom-like aesthetic, sure, but it still looks really nice. I mean, this is from an indie label publisher, and very few indie titles look as good as this one does. The premise of the game is a little different to Doom, though, as it's leaning into some bullet hell elements, and the big difference is that the game can also be played co-op. So there's quite a lot to sink your teeth into here. If you'd like to check it out, it's hitting PC tomorrow, no word yet on console release. JoJo's Bizarre Adventure Battle-Type R is a remaster of a PS3-era anime fighter. It's hitting all platforms on the 2nd. Speaking of fighting games, LEGO Brawls. Now, I didn't know this, but apparently this was a mobile game that's now getting ported to all other platforms, releasing on the 2nd. This is entering that increasingly crowded platform fighting scene, and it's going up against Multiverses, which just announced 20 million players this week, so that's stiff competition between that and Smash. But the LEGO brand does have a fair amount of cash, so I don't doubt that it'll find some audience somewhere. It is local multiplayer, of course, making it perfect for family fun, or if you'd like to give your kids the joy of LEGO without having to shell out like $300 for a new set. And finally, speaking of shelling out the big bucks, The biggest release of the week is The Last of Us Part 1, the remake of Naughty Dog's opus, and a game that's mired in controversy owing to its aggressive $70 price point. The game does promise a complete revision of the game's art design, new, more detailed facial animations, improved enemy and partner AI, and a raft of accessibility options that are industry-leading. Despite this, many people feel that that $70 price tag is a bit of an ask, especially when paired with an increase in the price of the PS5 happening in the same week. Goddamn, that is some bad timing. I can tell you right now that I'm reviewing this one at the moment, and I'm under embargo, so I can't say any more on it right now. But that review will go live 12:01 a.m. on Thursday, Australian Eastern Standard Time, which is around Wednesday morning in the US. If you'd like to check out that review the minute it goes live, then be sure to hit the subscribe button and ding the notification bell. No matter what I say, I'm expecting an absolute bloodbath in the comments section, so you don't want to miss it. Hey, put this on your radar.
Sorted. Anything else?
Warning. The current temperature of Earth is approaching 100 million degrees Celsius.
Oh, great.
The Entropy Centre showed up a few months back and immediately piqued my interest for a bunch of reasons. I mean, the obvious one is that this has very strong portal energy, which we're all a sucker for, I guess. But those sorts of games are kind of a dime a dozen on Steam. The thing that really caught my attention here was the unique gameplay conceit involving time bending. Your portal gun doesn't open rifts through space-time, it just turns time backwards or forwards. That's more than enough of a setup for some really interesting puzzle scenarios. It doesn't hurt that the game looks pretty great, not exactly stunning, but the brutalism of the architecture is a nice departure from the clean and pristine finishing of the Aperture Science Labs. Plus, your gun talks to you. Not exactly the most popular trick right now, given the reception to High on Life, but I'm personally into it. There are trailers up for this one, but the developers have also recently released a big chunk of actual gameplay, so you can get a good look at how all of this plays. If you're interested, then can I suggest you wishlist it, as that always helps out the developers in a big way. I'll leave a link to it on my Steam Curator page, which also has a link to all of the other Put This On Your Radar titles I've covered recently. You'll find a link to that below the like button. Sort of free stuff time now, and we're in the last week of the month, which means you do need to grab yourself your PS Plus games, your Games with Gold, and your Twitch Prime goodies before they're gone for good. Plenty of great stuff this month, actually, particularly for PS Plus, who are giving away Tony Hawk Remaster and Yakuza Like a Dragon, so don't miss out on those. We'll surely hear about the September lineups for each of these services very soon, probably like an hour before this episode goes to air, since that's when most major news seems to drop. Right now, we'll talk about Epic. As usual, they're doing their weekly giveaway. At the moment, you can get Ring of Pain, which is a roguelike deck builder meant to be pretty good, but the big ticket item is Destiny 2, which hit the Epic Game Store last week. There is a free-to-play version of it, of course, but Epic are also giving away the 30th anniversary DLC bundle, which gives you access to a new activity, a dungeon, a whole bunch of weapons, and the Gjallarhorn rocket launcher. That deal expires very soon though, like a few hours after this video goes live, so don't sleep on that one. Arriving on the 2nd of September, Epic will have three new offerings. The first one is some in-game content for free-to-play dodgeball title Knockout City. Next up is Submerged Hidden Depths. This was actually a Stadia exclusive for a while, but has since arrived on other platforms. It's a very chill, very beautiful exploration-focused game where you make your way through the remains of a drowned world. I've heard nothing but good things about it, so it's definitely one to check out if you're into stuff like Journey or Abzu in particular. Finally, Epic are giving away Shadow of the Tomb Raider Definitive Edition, the concluding entry in the rebooted Tomb Raider trilogy. This package also includes a bunch of DLC that combines narrative and challenging tombs to explore, as well as new skills, weapons, and more. All of that is yours for free. Not bad. Only other thing to shout out right now is Game Pass, but it's sort of a heads up more than anything else. Xbox and Humble Bundle have just announced that they're getting into bed together, and basically all the good stuff that Humble are publishing over the next few months is headed to Game Pass day one. A few key things to call out. First up, Moonscars is a very promising 2D Souls-like RPG with fantastic art and animations. Proteus is a boomer shooter that's been reviewing very well during its early access period. Midnight Fight Express, which dropped last week. Ghost Song, which is like a cross between Metroid and Nier Automata. And finally, Signalis, which is looking to be an S-tier PS1 era-inspired survival horror game. I played and featured all of these games earlier in the year in my Indie Spotlight video, so Xbox are definitely eating well when it comes to indie offerings. Keep an eye out for these as they all drop in the next month or two. Our feel-good story for the week is a double-edged sword, to be honest. Just last week, I lamented the fact that Kojima was now my sworn enemy, for he has now entered the merciless world of podcasting. I could handle Meghan Markle, but Kojima? That one cuts deep. No sooner had Kojima announced his podcast intentions to the world than the safety and security of my YouTube bubble was also threatened by none other than Masahiro Sakurai, famed developer at the helm of both Kirby and the Smash Brothers series. A regular on YouTube where he would reveal new Smash characters while playing with two controls at the same time, Sakurai has now officially become a YouTuber. He has started a YouTube channel called Masahiro Sakurai on Creating Games, which already has over 369,000 subscribers. Nice. The channel is just fucking wholesome as hell. It's just Sakurai teaching us about cool game design shit, like how freezing the action for a moment can greatly intensify the impact of something, or the relationship between fun, risk, and reward, and heaps of other stuff. It's just awesome to hear directly from an actual game design genius about the art of making video games, and I think it's so awesome that he's using YouTube as a platform to put this out there. Incidentally, I am very much looking forward to his first G Fuel flavor. I will be pre-ordering that one. And that, ladies and gentlemen, was the week in video games. We've got The Last of Us review hitting the channel less than 24 hours from now, so like I said, be sure to subscribe, ding the notification bell, and pray for me. If you like this video or found any part of it useful, then it'd be awesome if you could just hit the like button. It's a really big deal in the YouTube algorithm. It helps me out a ton, so I always appreciate when people take the time to do that. Just as I always appreciate you stopping by for my lukewarm hot takes, you have been a great audience. Thank you, and a big thank you to this week's sponsor, Green Man Gaming. Alright, so we all know the next Destiny 2 expansion was revealed last week, Lightfall. I spent a good chunk of last episode nerding out over it since it looks awesome, and I'm super pumped just to abandon all of my IRL commitments for a solid month and do nothing but play it when it launches February 28th next year. Now, I don't pre-order games, but I do pre-order expansions for the games I'm currently playing. Back in the day when I played WoW, I pre-ordered expansions for that. Same thing for Final Fantasy XIV, and same thing for Destiny 2 Lightfall. Not only because I'm pumped for it and I really want to play it, but also because Green Man Gaming are doing 16% off, and for me here in Australia, that meant I saved nearly $25. Now, to be clear, that is a Steam key that is delivered directly to you at the time of purchase, meaning that you get immediate access to all of the pre-order bonuses, and you've locked in that discount since it probably won't last forever. One thing to note about that discount is that it will work in most regions, but that some are excluded. If you haven't heard about Green Man Gaming before, then you have been missing out. I've been buying stuff from them for years because they always offer excellent prices on PC titles, but they're not a grey market key reseller. Every single key they sell has been sourced directly from the publisher themselves, so there's no scammy stolen keys that end up getting cancelled weeks or months after you've bought them. It's 100% legit, all the money goes directly to the publisher, and all the savings go directly to you. If Destiny 2 doesn't float your boat, then be sure to check out GMG's other stuff, since they're always dropping huge discounts on titles. For example, I checked today and I saw they're selling Red Dead 2 for 57% off, Guardians of the Galaxy for 50% off, and the upcoming Hogwarts Legacy for 12% off. Over 6 million gamers have purchased from Green Man Gaming over the years. That's a lot of people. Green Man have over 9,000 games in their library. That's a lot of games. And a lot of those are on sale right now. Our pile of shame can never be too high. Pile it sky high with Green Man Gaming. Thank you, Green Man, for sponsoring the video, and thank you for watching it.